I'm Addison, and I'll be interviewing Lawson Giles on Tuesday, March 27, 2017, at the Peoria Public Library, Lincoln Branch. This interview is being conducted for the Veterans History Project of the Library of Congress. Can you tell us a few things about your childhood and how you grew up, like how it was for you as a kid? Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, I grew up in a town called York, Alabama, which is a kind of a small town, probably less than 3,500 people. Lived in a rural setting. You know, we had farms and raised most of our food, a lot of our food. You know, cow, pigs, chicken. So it was a good childhood. And went to school there in York. Went to one school for 12 years. The school I went to went all the way from the first through the 12th grade. So I only had to get used to going to one school. Graduated from that in 1967. Then went to college at Alabama A&M University in Huntsville, Alabama. And was there until 1971. And in 71, I graduated in August 1971. And then was unable to get a job, so went to Boston, Massachusetts, to live there for 3 or 4 months, you know, looking for jobs, and did find somewhat of a job, but it was nothing in my field, you know, the area that I had gone to school for. And at that time, the Vietnam War was going on, so people was, you know, getting drafted and going to Vietnam at least six or seven months after they got drafted. And a lot of them from my hometown even was getting killed. So I tried to figure a way that I didn't have to go to Vietnam, so I volunteered for the Navy in October 1971. And went to a boot camp down in Orlando, Florida. I was down there until February 1972. And from there, I went to Officers Candidate School up in Newport, Rhode Island. And I was there from February 1972 until July 1, 1972, from February to July in that OCS. Then we was commissioned, and on July 1, at that time, I got orders to a ship in Norfolk, Virginia, a ship by the name of USS Mount Whitney. Went on, after I got out of OCS, I went to a couple of special warfare schools, you know, to get ready to serve on the ship. Specific jobs on the ship. So I reported on board the ship in August of 1972. And then about September or so, we deployed. We went to the Europe, around the Spain and Portugal area, all maneuvers. But other countries, most of them were basically the British. We were working with the British on maneuvers. And so I stayed in the Navy for until May 1975. And during that time, I was actually stationed on that ship for the whole time, but we did quite a few visits to different foreign countries, and not for my Navy career, I probably would not have gotten to visit a lot of places that I did get to see. We went to France and Denmark, Turkey, Germany, a whole broad range of places that we visited. Then we went to the yards, the ship, to the shipyard for a overhaul, and that was in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We were there for about 6 or 7 months, and after we got out, we went to Gitmo, and that's down in Cuba for refresher training. And while I was in Philadelphia, that's where my first daughter was born, there at the Naval Hospital there in Philadelphia. And during the time that I was in Gitmo, went down there about March of 1975, and actually I was released from active duty in May 1975.
Okay. So did you, when did you meet your partner during the Navy?
My wife. well, actually we met at in college. Alabama A&M University.
So how could you guys stay in contact with each other?
Well, just by mail, and that's about it. You know, phone calls and mail while I was overseas. So, yeah.
Okay. Did you what kind of friendships did you make?
I really met some good people in the Navy, actually. Some of the people that I met while I was in the Navy, we're still friends and communicate on a pretty regular basis, once or twice a year, at least twice a year, you know, we'll call and talk, even visit, you know. And so it was a real good experience.
Could you stay in contact with your family while you were there too?
Mm-hmm. But again, it was by phone and mail at that time, because at that time we didn't have internet, you know, so we didn't have that luxury, you know, so it was basically mail, and it would take roughly about 2 weeks or so to get a letter from our home port there in Norfolk, Virginia, to wherever we were. Whatever port was in, because what would happen was they would put the mail in the mail, but you know, we would only receive mail about once a month whenever we go in the port, you know, and they would have mail waiting for, you know, for the ship. So everybody that's on the ship that had mail, they would get the mail at that time.
So when the ship landed, did you guys get free time?
Actually, when the ship would pull in the port in the foreign countries, most time we would be there probably about a week and a half or 2 weeks. And for most of that time, you know, we would have what we call liberty. And that means that you're free to leave the ship and go socialize. At that time, but the only thing is, you know, you're on the ship, especially when you're going over, you know, we're leaving Norfolk, going over to Europe, and the first port that we would get to would, I'd say, Portugal, Spain, you know, Portugal, maybe Barcelona, and that would be about a 2 week trip from the time we leave Norfolk until we get to the first port.
It must have been good to have those breaks so you can take your mind off of the war or the Navy.
Yeah, it was, you know, to get an opportunity to go ashore, you know, and meet some of the natives, and you know, and they were normally pretty friendly people that you would meet over there, so you would enjoy striking up a conversation with them and talking about that, and, you know, how they live compared to how we live. And so it was a good learning experience. You get to bring back some unique souvenirs and that type of stuff.
That's nice. Where were you when the war ended?
I was actually in the Vietnam War in it. I was in May 1975, I believe. It was about 3 or 4 days before I was released from active duty. Because my ship did not actually go to Vietnam, because we were stationed on the East Coast, and most of the ships that went to Vietnam were ships that were stationed on the West Coast. So for that reason, the part of the world that we protected was Europe, you know, that part of the world. Whereas the West Coast, they was concerned about, you know, the Far East, which was where Vietnam was.
So you probably returned home by ship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Yeah, we would leave our last port and come back in the Norfolk. But the thing about that is, even though we would have a schedule, departure time, but that schedule could change depending on the environment, what's going on, because when we went to, on my first, we call them cruises, on my first cruise where we went, supposed to be to the Mid-Atlantic, and it was supposed to be about a 4 month cruise, but it ended up being about 7 or 8 months because there was a conflict that came up whereas I think it was back in maybe 73 or something. They had the 7 day war. It was something, and I can't remember the exact, but it was something that went on, some kind of conflict. So we got extended to stay until someone could relieve us. So, and since the other ship had just come back to their home port, you know, they couldn't come right back, so we just had to be extended until they could get somebody to relieve us.
Oh, so when you came back home, I bet your family was really happy. How did they welcome you back?
Yeah, they were. They were ecstatic. Them and my extended family, my mother, father, because they was still in Alabama, so most time when I get back, I would take a few days off and go to Alabama and visit them.
Was it like a big party when you came back, or it was just like, you had to stop by houses?
we would have, I wouldn't say a real big party, but, you know, dinner. Special, we'll get back.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm. So, how did you readjust to your civilian life?
I suppose when I first got out, I got out of the Navy. It took a while to get a job, you know, but eventually I did get a job after about 4 or 5 months. And to helped me to readjust. I went back to school. I had a degree in sociology. I went to the Navy. But when I got back, I used the VA loan, the VA educational benefits to go back to school to get a degree in accounting. And I had gotten a degree in sociology from Alabama A&M. And I was in Norfolk when I got out. So I went to school there in Norfolk, Virginia, Norfolk State University, and got a degree in accounting. And that's one of the stepping stones that got me to, you know, where I am now, being able to use that veterans educational benefits to get a degree in accounting. So,
you do stay in contact with your fellow veterans?
Mm-hmm. Right. Actually, there's a website that, you know, where you could go on and people who used to be on, who were stationed on that ship at one time or another, you know, they also on that site and go in and communicate with them.
Do they live in Peoria or?
No, they live all over. to live in North Carolina. Actually, he's the dean of Duke University, the dean at Duke University. Another one is in Florida, and then I got a couple in South Carolina, so yeah.
When was the last time you guys got together?
The last time was in a little bit before I retired from Caterpillar, about 2011. South Carolina. Now, we talk pretty frequently, but I haven't seen him since he retired from the Navy. I went to his retirement party. That was, I'm going to say, about 2010, maybe.
Are you a member of any of the veterans organizations?
Let me see. Other than the Naval Reserve Association and the American Legion, I'm a member of those organizations. American Legion is a local, there is a local chapter here in Peoria.
Do they go out to schools, or you guys just meet up with each other?
Well, we just meet, we have a local office here that we just meet, and we do projects for the, you know, for the community.
What have you done since you separated from the military?
Since I got separated from the military, my first thing that I did was I worked there as a juvenile probation counselor in Norfolk, Virginia, about 2 years, and during that time I was going to school at Norfolk State, and when I graduated from Norfolk State with my degree in accounting, Caterpillar came over recruiting accountants. So I was hired by Caterpillar at that point, and that was in 1978. So I came to Peoria to work for Caterpillar as an accountant. And so that's basically the only job that I've had since I've got out of the Navy with Caterpillar.
We're almost done. So we're going to wrap it up with the reflections.
Okay.
How did your wartime experiences affect your life?
I did. Well, I think it made me more mature because I went to Alabama A&M University before I went to the Navy. And while I was there, you know, I was kind of immature, didn't know for sure what I wanted to do, and didn't actually study and get the grades that I had potential, up to my potential. But after going to the Navy and having responsibilities and seeing what life was all about, and actually just become a more mature person after I got out of the Navy and went back to school, you know, I could tell that I was more focused and, you know, and really thought that I, you know, to me it was a second chance, you know, by having gone to service and getting some of the benefits that they offer veterans. Okay. And then also, after I came to Peoria, I joined the Naval Reserves and stayed in the Naval Reserves for, 78 to 1992, so I don't know how long that was. I stayed in the Naval Reserves here in Peoria, Illinois.
So you kept yourself busy.
Yeah, right. And during the Naval Reserve, you know, you go back on that to do the 2 weeks every year for refresher training. And also, you train at the local reserve center 1 weekend a month.
Mm.
So it keeps you in touch with the Navy.
That's good. What are some life lessons you learned from the military?
Well, one thing I learned is that when you have a responsibility and you are accountable for something, if you're the person in charge, then the people under you, if they do a good job, you get the credit. If they do a bad job, you old men are there. So it's that leadership thing where, you know, you're responsible and you just have to take the good with the bad.
Were you like the captain of the Navy kind of?
Well, I was the department head of the division officer when I was on the when I was in this, not enlisted, but when I was on active duty on the ship. I had a division called Second Division, and it was a deck division. They were responsible for keeping the ship maintained, painted.
How has your military service impacted your feelings about the war and the military in general?
Well, I guess it has changed somewhat since when I was first had to go. I didn't see it as being my choice, to go. It's just one of the things that I had to do, that I was more or less forced to do. Go to the Navy, go to the Army, at that time because of the draft, you didn't have any choice. But after I got in and got accustomed to their ways and the way they do things, got to the point where I enjoyed it and really enjoyed my time in the service and felt proud that I was able to do that. And also, since I've been out and, and being a veteran, something good for the country.
That must be a good feeling.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
What message would you like to leave for the future generations who will hear or view this interview?
Well, I would just like to tell them that, you may not want to do it, but it's a good, going to service is a good way to get both financial benefits and educational benefits, and also to become a more mature leader and person and learn how to lead men.
So kind of like stay in school sort of?
Oh yeah, continuous learning, yeah, right. and I think just about all branches of military would say that it's a continuous learning process, and while you're in that service, you have all kinds of opportunities to get free education. That helps you to advance, to advance your career.
Is there anything you feel we haven't discussed or should be added to this interview?
Oh, let me see. No, I really can't think of anything right off hand. But I'd just like to say to thank you guys for allowing me to have this interview. And I hope that you got something out of it, and that the people who see the interview also get something out of it.
It was nice having you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.